All right, Shabbat Shalom. Shalom. I'm gonna say Shabbat Shalom. Shalom. It is good to be here tonight. We're going to do a study tonight. A simple study, but at the same time, a very profound study. And I pray that this message goes out worldwide as we seek to reach the remnant of our people, the true biblical Hebrew Israelites that are all around the world. We know that we have people who watch and who listen to us in Jamaica, in Guam. We know that we have some people in the UK, my brothers and sisters in the UK. We have some brothers and sisters who are watching us in Canada and in South America, in Mexico, as well as in the motherland. We have some people viewing us from Ghana, from Uganda, South America, and we are blessed and privileged. If I didn't mention your country, Shalom, we still salute you, as well as everybody else who has been adopted into the family. We know that it's one family. Somebody else say amen. And the love that we have one for another is not based upon simply bloodline, but our loving commitment one to another is based on our relationship with our Abba Yah through his only begotten son, our HaMashiach, whose name is blessed forever. He is Yahushua. Somebody say amen. So tonight, I'm going to be dealing with a word tonight that I believe, it's kind of interesting, I believe we forgot. I believe we have forgotten this word. So would you bow with me, please? Abba Yah Todah, thank you for this day. Thank you for allowing us to come together at this hour and study the holy manuscript that you so graciously have given us as a gift. We understand that your word is true and it is established in heaven, and therefore nothing humans can do can destroy your word. It is as relevant today as it was the moment it was penned, as it was the moment you spoke it. Help us to understand that, realize that, as we seek to get a deeper understanding on tonight. In the name of Yahushua, we pray. Amen. Tonight's word is what does that say? Remember. Tonight's word is remember. Y'all say that with me. Say remember.
Remember.
Come on, say it again. Say remember.
Remember.
Here is a word used in our manuscript hundreds and hundreds of times by our Abba and by our Holy Messiah, Yahushua, as well as other writers, as they were moved by the Ruach HaKodesh. They said, remember. Now, how many of you all believe that even though we were told to remember, many of us have forgotten? Now, I will say this. You cannot remember something that you were not taught in the first place. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
No, watch this. How many of you all, since we've been walking in truth, and studying this scripture from the original language, have come to realize that there's the possibility that we can have one word and yet two different understanding of that particular word. How many of y'all will admit that? Amen. And so tonight, I want to continue down this road of Greek thought versus Hebrew thought when it comes to certain words. And one of the reasons, Zion, that we are all messed up concerning some of the laws, statutes, commandments, precepts of our Abba Yah is because of a misunderstanding of, watch this, the Hebrew meaning of a word. We must interpret all scripture through the eyes and the culture and the people who wrote the scripture. If you understand that, would you say amen? Amen. Does it make any sense for us living in America, speaking English, and that's not even the real English, we're speaking broken English. Does it even make sense for us in English to try to understand something that was written, watch this, not in German, not in French, y'all with me here? Not in Latin, not even Greek. It was written in Hebrew. So in order to understand, we've got to know what? You gotta know Hebrew. You gotta learn it from the Hebrew perspective. And tonight, I've got an interesting word for us. It's this word, remember. In Greek, the word is memnesko. And somebody give me a definition to this word that you think means remember. What's the definition for remember?
Recall.
Somebody said to what?
Recall.
Recall. To retain. What else? Huh? Don't forget, which is, but it's all abstract, right? And I told you that that's what we do in English is oftentimes we operate in the abstract. And of course, Greek is also abstract. Because just like you said, and I need to tilt this camera up a little bit so this won't be annoying to people. Can you tilt it? One of the things that you've got to understand about Greek is that the Greeks operated in, I hate to use this term, but they operated in fuzzy-wuzzy land. In other words, you didn't have to have something concrete to base your word on. And so here the word remember simply means in our mind, in the Greek way of thinking, to recall something, to just be able to remember something, or to retain information, or simply not to forget. Right? And therefore, as long as you can remember something intellectually, you might feel like that you have actually fulfilled all of the commandments of the Most High Yah to remember. Are y'all with me on that? So therefore, when you hear somebody get up and say, remember this, you feel like if I was able to do what? Recall it, then I have obeyed this verse. Right? Let's look at the, I think it's, let's go to the book of the Psalm. Hope I got the right one here. This just came to me. Around 103. Let me see if I got the right one. There it is. Watch this. Bless Yahuwah. Psalm 103. Oh, my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Woo, that's a whole sermon. But then it says, bless Yahuwah, oh, my soul, and here's a word, and forget not all his benefits. So a person would say, well, all I got to do to obey this psalm is just to think about his benefits. Do you see how in English, with the Greek way of thinking, you can fulfill a passage of scripture by simply what you think, recalling it to mind, whereas there is no action placed behind it. And so, memnesco, when you look that word up in any dictionary, it is going to say to recall, or to remember, or to call to mind. And then you're going to get a nuance. Y'all know what a nuance is? A nuance is sort of like a small deviation or alternation of a word. It's a nuance that you're going to get in Greek that gives you a hint to what it really meant in Hebrew. And here is your nuance from this word, memnesco. It's the nuance mention. So when you look up this word, it's going to say to recall or to remember, to call to mind, but then you're going to get a little nuance to the word mention. What you get here, small little piece that involves an action. And in this case, it is to open your mouth and say it. Okay, so at least the Greek acknowledges that the Hebrew word that they got this word mentioned from, that they got this word remember, carries with it the idea of to mention it. Y'all in the room with me? Amen.
Amen.
All right. So then, since we know that basically Greek means just to think about it, recall it, whatever, got a little nuance called mention, we're able to now find the Hebrew word that we got this Greek word from. Now, remember, we start in English with the word remember. We go to the Greek with the word menasco. Memnesco or menesco. And we end up with the Hebrew word zakar. I'll spell it in an English transliteration. Zakar. Yeah, oh yeah, I'm going to bring up some verses. All right, the Hebrew word zakar, y'all got it? That's where we get this word, remember, in Hebrew is zakar. You'll see it in different forms, but this is the basic form. Now, all you Hebrew students out there, you already know by looking at this word what the Hebrew letters are. So remember, Hebrew goes from what? Right, right. So we do it like this. We know the vowels don't have to be there, right? So we can do this and this, and we got Zakar. So what is the first one? Zayin. And then the next one? Exactly. Good job. And then the last one? Right. Beautiful. Beautiful. And what does this first one represent? Y'all got your bulletins. What is the first letter? What? It's a
weapon.
Claw weapon.
Right. So this idea of separation. To set apart. So almost you're starting to see something already. And then what is this one? Which represents? Huh? No, not the mouth. The what? Palm of the hand. Palm of the hand. Palm of the hand. Which then tells us, and that's the picture graph, so it gives us, y'all have the bulletin. Huh? To receive.
To be blessed.
To bless. And then the last one, the resh?
Head person first.
Now, so whenever you zakar, you see now that there has to be something that is set apart or divided that you are to either receive or bless or to give, right? And then, of course, the head represents first or, and what's the other word for it?
Person.
Person. So you can see when you put these letters together, now watch this, that to remember brings forth the action of blessing a person or blessing an act or an act that has been done in a positive way towards someone. You see that? In other words, watch this. Because we got a resh, we understand that the resh could actually represent a mind. So that this word can actually be to be mindful of something. You see that? So to think about something, right? But to be mindful, but this cough right here is giving us an action. Just thinking about it ain't enough. You gotta do something. So if you think about it and you don't do it, as far as the Bible is concerned, you didn't what? You didn't remember. Am I moving too fast for Zion? Okay, in Greek, remember I told you, all you got to do is think about it, right? But remember I said, it's an abstract word. You could just think about something and feel like you've accomplished what the text said, but not so in Hebrew. In Hebrew, zakar never means to just think. You've got to do something based on what has come back to your remembrance. And therefore, we get a multitude of words with the root word or with the idea of zakar, root word. And of course, one is properly, watch this, to mark something. I'm reading straight off the definition now. In other words, you're gonna mark it because it's important and you gotta come back to that spot. You got that? You mark it so that it can be what? Recognized. We do it all the time. Amen. You mark certain things, especially if it looks like everything else. So you mark one thing so that it will stand out from the other. And I'll tell you, I'll go further with in that in a minute. But not only that, remember I told you there was a nuance in the Greek to mention? So this word zakar carries with it the idea of marking something, but also speaking well of it. It could be of speaking well of a person or an act. Are you in the room, Zion? So that when you remember something in the Hebrew, it's not just coming to mind, but it's also something that is mentioned, that is spoken, and it's really something that then you end up doing as a result of for the person or the act itself. All right? Very powerful. To remember also carries with it the idea. Now watch this one. And this is the one I want to hang my hat on tonight. Watch this. To speak on behalf of. Write that down. To speak on behalf of someone or something. To remember something in the Hebrew mind is never just a matter of just it coming back to your thoughts. But it has to do with an action. What came to your mind was then put in action. And you spoke well, you remembered, and you acted on the behalf of someone or something. You see, in Greek, it doesn't matter if you do something or not, long as you think about it. That's why so many people can not feed the hungry. Because as long as they thought about feeding the hungry, they feel good that at least they thought about it. But when the manuscript says to remember those among you that are in low estate, he's not saying just remember that there's some people around you that's in low estate. He means feed the hungry people and clothe those who need clothes that are among you in lower state. Do you see it now? Put in action. Okay. So if the word remember simply means to think, to recall to your memory, then many of the verses in the Bible won't make any sense at all. Now I'm going to do these few verses and then I'll be out your way for tonight. Somebody get Genesis chapter 8. Y'all remember the law of first mention, right? This particular word, it's a car, has in it this word. When you look it up, you will see a preface. But when you see after the preface, you'll see the actual word. In Genesis chapter 8, verse 1. Can somebody read it and read it really loud?
God remembered Noah.
Wait, what?
And
Yah, Genesis chapter 8. Let me catch it with you, Aki, because I want you to look at this verse. Genesis 8, verse 1 says, and Yah, which is incredible, remembered who?
No.
Does that suggest to you that somehow Yah had forgot Noah and was like, Noah, yes, build a boat. Okay, for 100 years, I built this boat. Noah, yeah, I need you to get all the animals, all the clean, amen, sevens. I know y'all don't know that. You think everything went on two by two. And all the clean went on by what? Sevens. And then I want you to put on the unclean, two by two. Yes, Yah, Abba Yah, he does it, right? Now, Noah, preach it, 120 years, now watch this. They get on the boat, Noah, tell the folk they got 7 days. Noah said, okay, and he go to holler. And I think he hollered like this. Ah, 7 days. I don't know what he did, but he told the whole world, you got seven, talk back. Days, and the flood's coming. And do you know that those people ignored him? And on the seventh day, the Bible says in King James Version, the self same day, which is very interesting, which literally means that to the second, Yah brought the flood by bringing down the heavens, right? Bringing up the flood waters and destroying the earth in a very tumultuous scene here. It's very interesting to watch that scene. And it says, and Yah shut the door, right? When he was in, Yah shut the door. And then after the waters had, what is right here in chapter 7, verse 24, and the waters prevailed upon the earth 150 days. Then when you come down to the next verse, 8:1, and our Elohim Yah remembered Noah.
Amen.
So in 40 days, you think he forgot Noah? So do you see how the English translation won't make any sense to just recall or to just retain information? You know, we used to sing a song back at the Christian church. Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me in your glory. Do Lord, oh do Lord. As though you up here with a forgetful Abba, who done forgot his own child. If my daughter came to me talking about, Dad, do you remember me? Do you understand what she was trying to say? I mean, do you think I'm losing? I mean, of course I remember my children. Are y'all in the room? Because I'm going to go fast after this. Obviously, the Most High is not talking about simply recalling that he have his son on a boat. Come on. Oh, yeah. I forgot. Noah's still out there. That's not what it means at all. He really means that Yah makes mention of Noah and begins to move on his behalf. What does he need? He needs the world to be repopulated. He needs that ark to find some dry land. Y'all get it? Things got to go back the way it was because Yah just tore up everything. And just like he told Noah about repopulating the world again through him, he was now, watch this, going to do what he said he would do. That is how he, quote unquote, remembered. He recalled his promises that he made, and now he's getting ready to make, well, he already made good on his promise because he saved Noah and his family, but now he's about to use Noah to repopulate the whole world. And give him a rainbow in the sky in order to be a what? Reminder. Let's go to another one. Genesis chapter 30, verse 22, you Hebrews tonight. And let's see again how to just to think about something cannot be the biblical way of understanding the word remember. You can't just think about it. Genesis chapter 30, verse 22. Somebody have that?
And Elohim remembered Rachel.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim hearkened to her and opened her womb.
Oh! And Elohim did what? Remembered who? Sign the Bible. So again, do you think Elohim forgot Rachel? And then all of a sudden say, oh, I forgot. Jacob got two wives. He got Rachel. I forgot all about her. No, that's not what happened. The word there is Zakar. And the root word there is Zakar. And Zakar means that he spoke or mentioned something, but watch this, or did something for her. And in this case, his zakar, the zakar of Rachel, was, what did he do for her? He opened her womb and allowed her to become pregnant.
Right.
Now, she was the second wife of Jacob, whom he loved. The first wife he had was given to him by trickeration. Whatever that word is. You know, Laban, you know, did some business that was crooked. But nevertheless, Jacob loved Rachel. And in her mind, watch this, Yah was blessing Leah. Yeah, ooh. and not blessing her. In her mind, Yah was being a respecter of person, and she didn't understand it. She's like, I'm the one he wanted in the first place. I don't get it. And so she starts to pray to the Most High, and the Bible, I don't have to make it up, it's right here. It says, and Elohim remembered Rachel. He heard her call, or her cry, and he listened to her cry, and he opened her womb, and she conceived a son. And her testimony of the conception was, now Yah has done what? Taken away my reproach. Can't nobody talk about me now, because Yah has spoken on my behalf. Whatever it was that was stopping me from getting pregnant, Yah spoke on my behalf and did something for me that now I'm no longer a reproach. You all see that? You see how he didn't, you see how remember just don't mean, oh, I remember that, no. Another example, quickly. Let's go to Genesis chapter 40. We're still in the book of Bereshit. This is the first book of the Bible. Can you see a pattern? You're starting to see a pattern that there's some things we're supposed to, remember. There's a pattern being laid down that we're supposed to grasp and never forget. Let me show you this one. Genesis chapter 40, verse 14. Genesis 40, 14. I think you all know this story. Somebody with it, read it for me.
But think on me, when it shall be well with thee. And show kindness, I pray thee, unto me. And make mention unto Pharaoh, and bring me out of this house.
Now, did you hear Joseph? Watch this. This is the same Joseph that his mama is the one who said, I want to get pregnant. And then the Bible says, and Yah remembered her. Now he's in prison. This boy, Joseph, is in prison, which is unbelievable, by the way, how he got there. His own brothers. Unbelievable. His own brothers sold him out for chicken change. For like 20 pieces of silver, which wouldn't equal today, it wouldn't equal $30. Sold their brother into slavery to the Midianites, and y'all know what ended up happening. He had done nothing wrong. The only thing that that boy ever did against his brethren, he just happened to be the one that his daddy loved the most. That ain't his fault. You think he just said, hey, I want to be the one my daddy loved the most. No, that's not what happened. Pop said, you know what? You're the firstborn of the woman I really wanted to marry in the first place. I ain't mad at my other sons, but this boy right here reminds me of his mama. And now that his mama has died, because that's a whole nother story, she died in childbirth on her second child, Benjamin. But that's, we won't get into that. Then Joseph became the one I'm gonna hold to me, gave him a coat of many colors to do what? Set him apart. I wish I had time to talk about that. But that, whenever the family got together to take a family photo, you didn't have to guess which one was Papa's favorite. He was the one that had colors in his garment. Nevertheless, he finds himself in slavery, and as a slave, he works for his master. It's a terrible situation. He builds the master's house up, and his master's wife starts liking him because, you know, Hebrew men, they just attractive. And she couldn't help herself. She wanted to get with the brother. He said, nah, man, you belong to my master, and y'all know what happened. She tried to force him into bed, and he said no, left his clothes, and they put him in prison. And down in the prison, he stayed there a long time, and it came to pass that two men who worked for Pharaoh got thrown in the same prison and ended up in the same cell. They were cellies. Y'all know what that is, huh? They was bunk, you know what I'm saying? They in the same room, eating out the same mess hall. And they in line one day, and they having a problem. And one brother says to the other, he said, man, I'm having this dream, and it is tearing me up inside. I can't interpret it. And the other guy said, I'm having the same dream. Man, I'm having a dream too, and I don't know what mine is. And they end up telling him the dream. He said, man, tell me what y'all dreaming. He finally told him what the dream was. He said, whew, okay. Let me see. How I'm going to tell y'all this. For you, Pharaoh's gonna call you and you're gonna be restored to your position. He was like, yes. He told the other fellow, said, now for you, Pharaoh's gonna call you too. And he was like, yes. He said, ah, don't be too low. Jumping the gun, brother. You're gonna lose your head. And it happened just like that. So when the Pharaoh finally called for the brethren, Joseph said, I believe this was to the cupbearer, right? He said to him, he said, now when you stand, I gotta stop that on Tuesday, on Thursday night. This is not preaching time, this is Bible study. When you stand before Pharaoh, what did he tell him? Think on me. Remember me.
And mention me.
Huh?
Two same words. And mention me.
And mention me. Put that back up a little bit. I'm sorry. Now watch this. I can stand up. Now watch this. Watch this. Don't miss this. Do you really think that do you really think that Joseph was just telling this guy to think about me? Just let it come to your brain, man, that I was here. No. The text tells you that remembering, right, has to do with speaking well. Now, what was the whole point of him speaking well to Pharaoh for? Right, because he's down in prison. He said, man, look, if you just tell Pharaoh about me, and how well I'm doing down here, and how I have this ability to interpret dreams, maybe I can get out earlier. But the text says when he got restored, he forgot. Now, does that mean he forgot who Joseph was? No. It really means he didn't say nothing. He was so happy to do his own thing, he never said a word for Joseph until Pharaoh ended up having a dream. I think, I'm not sure, check me out on this one. I think it was something like 2 years later. That's a long time to be left in jail, especially when you're innocent in the first place. But it was a while later. Y'all fact check that, because it's going out worldwide. Pharaoh has a dream, and then the Bible says that the man remembered. There it is. That he remembered Joseph and went to Pharaoh and said, Pharaoh, I really kind of tripped out. I was supposed to tell you this 2 years ago. He said, brother, I mean, you've been suffering with these dreams, man. You've been turning up, man. You're having all kind of problems. And I could have helped you a long time ago. It's a brother in prison can interpret dreams. His name is Joseph. Now, what is he doing? He's making mention with the purpose of blessing. With the hopeful, with the hope that if I mention him in a positive light and I vouch for him, watch this, that my vouching for him to the Pharaoh might just get this fella a chance to stand before Pharaoh himself. And you know what ended up happening? That very thing. And of course we know as a result of him mentioning Joseph, that Pharaoh said, bring him here. And then Joseph interpreted the dream. He had two dreams and they were one. He said, man, the dream of the corn and the dream of the cattle, man, it's the same, or the wheat and the cattle, it's the same dream. Egypt is in trouble. And you better start storing up stuff for I think it's 7 years. Or it's, and then, y'all know the story. All right, so again, you can see this word remember cannot just mean to think about something. It has to move into the area of speaking on the behalf of something or someone or some event. Now, unless you think I only can study in the Old Testament, because I heard that's the new rumor. He only reads the Old Testament, which anybody who knows me knows that that's just not true. I don't even believe in the division of the Old and New Testament. I believe in the covenant and the fulfillment of the covenant. Amen. I believe in the promise and the fulfillment of the promises. Hallelujah. So here we look in the book of Luke chapter 23. Go there with me, please. Again, now this is quote unquote in the Greek. Now I told you all, the Bible's not written in Greek. The Bible's written in Hebrew, by Hebrews, to Hebrews. Now if you use the Greek definition and the English definition of this word, remember, this verse is not going to make any sense to you at all, even though it's written in your New Testament. Luke 23. By the way, I got a new Bible, a new manuscript. Thank God, Keith McGill, appreciate it. But I got to break it in. I never knew how much you memorize your old Bible. You know, you've been doing it so long, you just can flip to stuff. So it's taking me a little longer tonight. Because the pages are brand new. Yeah, they still sticking together. But I really like this this new manuscript, man. I really appreciate it. I'll give a shout out to them later on. All right, Luke chapter 23, verse 42. Now, let's start at 41. Where are we at? No, let's start at 40. I'll read it. Well, might as well start at 39, start at the beginning of the paragraph. And one of the malefactors, which were hanged, now watch this. This fella is nailed next to a homicidal. It's in the Bible. You don't have to try to make it up. This fella is hanging right next to the homicidal. It says, which were hanged, railed on him, talked about him, blasphemed him, saying, if thou be homicidal, save yourself and save us. Do you hear this Hebrew? He's on the cross, hands tied and nailed, bleeding, grasping for air, and does not have a repentant bone in his body. His spirit has not been touched at all, and yet this is the end of his life. The only thing he can say is, if. Listen, hard-headed, stiff-necked Hebrews been around ever since they've been Hebrews. Even if they're hanging right next to a HaMashiach. He's that close and still fixing his black lips to say something negative about our holy Messiah. If you're the Messiah. Save yourself and save us too. Now that's the one on the left. Now let's look at the one on the right. But the other answered, watch this. What did he do? Talk back. Stop. There's a rebuke here. Now, ain't this something? These two gangbangers in the same gang. They caught together. Justice has caught up to them. And you would think that they would be together against the Hamashiach to the very end. Wouldn't you think that? Because, you know, there's a thing out there saying, we think it's thieves. In other words, we partners in crime. And if we live together, and we stole together, and we robbed and murdered and killed together, then we're gonna die together. So there should have been some type of honor there. But when he heard the other fella railing on our holy Messiah, he was like, shut up. You need to completely shut your mouth. Now, I don't know what that was all about, Monet. Maybe 2 days before, they was in the cell talking about, you know what the truth is? If it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be here in the first place because I was minding my own business. No, man, you a grown man. You could have made your own decision. Y'all see how the argument could have went? Now we about to die. So what, man? So what? We're gonna go out like no suckers. No, you right. You right. We ain't going to go out strong. We're going to go out strong. Keep your head up, Aki. You keep your head up, Aki. And so, when their gangbanging leader got off the hook, because remember, Barabbas was the gang leader. When he got off the hook because of the Holy Messiah, they're now dying not with Barabbas, who they should have been killed with, but they're hanging with the Hamashiach. And this fella, he can't get it. And the other fella said, okay, look, man, you got to hush. You got to shut up. And I won't tell you what he really said, but he rebuked him, saying, do you have any fear of Elohim at all in you? I mean, Hebrew, are you rotten to the core? I mean, is there anything in you worth redemption at all? See, just because you bloodline Hebrew does not necessarily mean you recognize who the Hamashiach is, or whether or not you walk it in Torah, or whether or not you keeping the statutes and law and commandments of the Most High, or whether or not you have a heart. See, you don't fear Elohim. Thou art in the same, seeing that thou art in the same condemnation. Verse 41. Now he testified, and we, that's him, he's talking about him and the other thief on the cross, the other malefactor. He said, and we indeed justly, in other words, we dying because we deserve it. This is the due reward of our deeds. Man, you know we got caught, and we knew that if we ever got busted, we ever got caught, we already knew what the end was going to be, and we already said we wasn't going to go out like no sucker, but we didn't say we was going to go out like atheists. Because you don't seem to have a drop of the fear of the Elohim in you at all, and I ain't that far gone, just to let you know. I might look like it, because we both up here hanging. But you... Now watch what he says. I'm just trying to read the Bible. He said, but this man, he's talking about Yahushua now, hath done what? Nothing. Now didn't I tell y'all that our holy Messiah is sinless? If anybody knows the dirt on somebody, it's gonna be somebody who's dirty. Dirty people know the dirt on everybody. Amen. Am I in the room, Marky? Yep. People who deal in dirt know dirt. Okay, let me say it the way they say it out here in California. Game recognize game. Oh, ain't nobody here from the streets, I guess. What they saying now? I've been off the streets a long time. Maybe I don't know the language. What am I trying to say, y'all? I'm trying to say that if the Hamasiah was crooked, it would be another crooked person that would blast him out. That's just the way we are, Hebrews. We do that anyway. We're going to find what's wrong with him, but he said, this man ain't done nothing. Nothing wrong. Verse 42. And he said unto Yehoshua, this is shouting ground here, Master, which is the word for, I told you earlier, it's the word for teacher, which is the word more, right? A more, a teacher. Master, here's your word. Remember me when you come, where? Into your, into thy, it's your kingdom. Oh my goodness, great. When you come to your kingdom, remember me. Hold on. With the Greek word, I should have put the Greek word up here. With the Greek word or the English word, remember, do you really think that that's what the thief on the cross was thinking? Hey man, remember that when you died, it was two people that died by you. Do you think that's what he was saying? In other words, just intellectually recall that you didn't die up here by yourself. Would that make any sense? I'm talking about, this is a New Testament verse, right? Would that definition of remember make any sense in this passage? No. The only thing that would make sense is the car, which is mention me. Don't just remember that I was a human. What I'm asking you to do is plead my case. When you get to your kingdom where you are the king, because I know that you are the son of the Most High Yah, and I know that our Hamashiach is the one who becomes the go-between Yah and man. And all I'm saying is, please mention me before the king. When you get to your kingdom, say something good about me. Speak on my behalf. Here's what he's saying. Help a brother out. I wish I had time, Mark. I'm feeling something here. I gotta shut it down, but I'm feeling something here because the nerve of him. What nerve does he have to ask the Hamashiach to remember him? Not intellectually remember, but to speak well on his behalf. What grounds, what basis does he have to actually make that kind of a claim and or make that kind of request from the Hamashiach? How can he even do it? Can I tell you? Isaiah said, oh, everyone who's thirsty, you can come get a drink. Everybody who's hungry, you can come buy some bread. And if you're broke, don't worry about it. It's free. All you gotta do is confess. That's a whole nother word. All you gotta do is agree with Yah and his Hamashiach. Didn't give a time limit. Didn't say when it was too late. Amen. Just said do it. I can go on and on. I can go into Psalms where David began to say certain things like, you know who I am. You know my uprising, my down sitting. You know my thoughts before I even think them. You know my thoughts afar off. And you remember my frame. You know that I'm nothing but dust. You know already that in me dwelleth no good thing. You already know that I'm already a wretch, undone. All I'm doing now is saying, based on what this, the promises toward the children of Yisrael who confessed you. That's all I got. I'm just asking you to remember, no, to speak well of me when you come to your kingdom. Now let's see what the Hamasiach said. Verse 20, verse 43. And Yahushua said unto him, are you out your mind? You've been stealing your whole life. Call yourself, go now, want me to remember you. But that's not in the Bible. How about this? Boy, you know it's too late now. You up here bleeding. That's not in the Bible either. How about this? Where were you? How come you didn't call me when you were stealing and robbing and raping and plummeting? Isn't that in there either? Did he say, listen here, Aki, you need to speak in tongues. Prove that you've been converted. Is that in here? Do you understand where I'm going with this thing? I'm trying to show you something. The Messiah said, verily, verily, I say unto you, watch this, today you will be with me. He knew by his request, he was asking for something to be done for him. When he said, remember me, he didn't just mean come to mind. He said, I need you to do something for me. And the Messiah answers the Zakar by saying, what I'm going to do for you is, I'm going to take you with me to paradise today. I'm not just going to intellectually remember you. I'm taking you, Aki. You going with me. Going with me. You taking a thief? That's a whole nother sermon. I got a sermon about that. I'm going to have to preach it again. It's been a while, but can you imagine what everybody's saying when they get to heaven? Get to paradise? Everybody cheering, open wide the gates. Y'all, we read that in our responsive reading. And the King of Glory shall come in. Who is this King of Glory? Yah, strong in battle, right? And that's what they're shouting at. The Hamasiach enters into paradise. And then you can almost see a couple of Hebrews that's already up there looking on the other side of Messiah saying, who's that? We thought you was coming in by yourself. Oh, I keep, by the way, hey man, what's your name? Oh, we just met a couple hours ago. Where'd you meet him? On the cross. So what did he do? Oh, he's a thief. No, I mean, but is he a great preacher? Is he a great prophet? Is he a great, I mean, if you brought him with you, I mean, oh no, he's just a thief. Been stealing his whole life. He a gangbanger. How'd he get here? Can you see the Hamasiach say it? How'd you get here? Matter of fact, anybody up here in paradise, wherever it is, anybody here got a problem with this thief coming home with me? Now he's doing what? Speaking on the people. Anybody got a problem? Adam, you got a problem? No. Hello? No problem. Man, I only had one commandment, and I messed that one up. You think I'm gonna have a problem with this fella? No, it's partly my fault. Got no problem. Noah, you got a problem? I ain't got no problem. You didn't hear me say a word. Man, I've been drinking my whole life. I got so drunk, I got naked in my own tent. And you asking me if I got a problem with it? I ain't got no problem. Abraham, how about you? You got a problem? Yeshua, please. You already know. I pimped my wife. And if it wasn't for you, the king would have slept with her. And you want to ask me if I got a problem with him? I ain't got no problem. Anybody else got a problem? Moses, you got a problem with me bringing this fella in? I'm a murderer. Yeah, I killed a man and buried him in the sand. And thought nobody saw it. I ain't got no problem with him. David, you got a problem? David said, come on in, brother. I'm just gonna keep dancing. I ain't gonna say nothing. I'm just still glad I'm dwelling in the house of Yah. You know I'm not gonna run this whole list all the way to the end. My point is this: the way we all get in is by Yah. Zakaring us, remembering us, speaking well on our behalf. Y'all, I went long. Can I give you just two verses more? I won't do a whole lot of commentary, just two verses more. Watch this. Go to the Revelation chapter 2, verse 5. Revelation chapter 2, verse 5. Quickly. We went through the whole Bible from Genesis to the Revelation chapter 2. Verse 5. This new Bible. I'll start at verse 1 quickly. And unto the angel of the assembly of Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know your works and your labor and your patience, and how thou cannot stand, cannot bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars, and has borne and has patience, and for my name's sake have labored and have not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee. I got a problem with you. What is it? Because you have, now watch this word, left your first love. Now you think that some kind of way he was in love with somebody, this church was, and then they left. And the idea really did not necessarily mean that they just like left, like they got a divorce or something. The real word here is the opposite of zakar. You stopped speaking about my commandments, my laws, my attributes. You stopped talking about, are y'all in the room with me now? You stopped declaring my message, which is the Torah. Because you do know at this time there was no quote unquote New Testament. Y'all know that, right? He said, you left your first love. Ahava. I don't have time that. I've already done a Bible study on that word. Now watch the solution to the problem. It's right in verse 5. He says, remember. That's the car. That means you got to mention it. You got to talk about it. You got to go back and speak well of it in order to bless it. Remember what? Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen. Watch this. And repent So obviously wherever you are now, you've fallen from where you were. So repent means go back, right? Turn around. That's what the word means. And do the talk back.
First works.
Oh no, do the third works. Oh, do the New Testament works. Do the prophet work. No, first works. What's the first works? What's the first works? It's Torah. It's the beginning of your book. It ain't that difficult, Zion. The first works is the things that are first. So how is it that we can claim to be following the Most High Yah and walking after him and refusing to do the very first work? It's because we forgot. And forget means we don't speak well of it anymore. We speak bad of it now. The law's done away with. Don't keep none of them commandments. Don't keep none of them precepts. We're in the New Testament now. Wait a minute. He said the first work. First work is the first. Can I live with this? Last one. I said I'm gonna give two more. Last one is this. Leviticus? No. Exodus chapter 20, around verse 8. And I'm for sure enough through. This is the longest lesson I've done in a long time. Exodus chapter 20, verse 8, and I'm gonna leave it right here. Can somebody please read that for me? What does it say? Exodus chapter 20, verse 8. Anybody, read it. Wait, what? Remember the what? The Shabbat. Why? To keep it set apart. Now, how is it possible for you to remember the day and not keep the day? How can you zakar Shabbat? Oh, by just thinking about it. Oh, I thought about the Sabbath. He said you zakar it because that's how you keep it Kodesh. That's how it stays separate from every other day, because they all look alike. Every day looks the same unless you mark one. And the one that you're marking to set aside from all the other ones is the seventh day, and we're going to call that Shabbat, because the word Shabbat means that you're going to come back to me in my house with me. All week long you're going to be busy, but one day a week you're coming back to me. That is the idea of the Shabbat. And in him is what? Rest. Are y'all with me, Zion? Can you remember the day and not keep the day? No. Now, in Greek you can. Oh, I remember the day supposed to be the Shabbat. But some of us don't even know that the Shabbat is the seventh day. We can't even recall to mind when the day really is. Whew. So, that's my lesson, the word remember. Yah wants us to remember him because he remembers us. Shalom, shalom.